never got meeting like this.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
is intentional on our part for the Advent season. We'll be explaining a little bit more about that later on. But just want to welcome you all to our worship today. Our announcements are actually going to happen at a different time in worship, so don't worry about that just yet. At this time, then, I'd just like to invite you to rise as we gather for the gathering with me. Blessed be God, the eternal, one and three, who was and is to come.
Blessed be God forever and ever.
During a season of busyness and in a culture that demands immediate response,
we pause and wait for your appearing.
In the midst of anxiety, chaos, and fear,
we pause and trust that your hand is leading us.
Uncertain about the future, weighed down with worries in the present,
we pause and know your presence fully.
Come, O Christ, and set us free.
Come, Emmanuel, bring your reign of justice and peace.
We wait for a new heaven and a new earth.
For righteousness is at home.
We invite you to join in our gathering hymn.
Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Salah. Our second reading is from 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 to 15. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire? But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth, where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. So also, our beloved brother Paul wrote to you according to the wisdom given to him. Here ends the second reading.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to rise for the reading of the Gospel lesson for today.
The Gospel lesson is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 25 to 34.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your Heavenly Father feeds them. Are you of not more value than they? And can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow, is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed your Heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Well, I'm hoping I've got
Heavenly and Jacob, Christmas candles are of no good to you. Jacob was startled by the stern response, and he laughed. It would do me much good not to stumble in the dark. Are you playing me, old man? I will not pay more than for your candles than they are worth. It's only 4 coppers. You can find, but you may find it costly. The old man's words were strange and curious. I have money. Give me the candle, Jacob shouted. It's too late. My family is waiting for me. I need illumination to find my way. Ah, it is illumination you desire, the candle maker said softly. That is what I need, Jacob replied. The candle maker nodded slowly. So you do. He took a candle, dipped it over a flame, placed inside the lantern's tin frame. Jacob dropped some coins on the counter, walked to the door. The old man's lips paused in an odd, amused smile. Merry Christmas, my brother, he said. A farewell surprised Jacob. To you as well, he stammered. He hastily stepped out of the darkness. Lantern lighted the white of the road ahead. Jacob would travel only a short distance when a shadow emerged from an alleyway. A robber, he thought fearfully. He yelled out his lantern. Who's there? He called. Then, in the light of the candle, he saw there was only a frail woman huddled against the cold. Sir, cried the woman, a pence, please. His eyes narrowly contempt the beggar. Then, as Jacob looked at her more closely, he gasped. He knew that face well. It was his mother's. Mother, what is this prank? Why are you greeting me as a beggar? Woman stared at him. Just to have a pence, sir. Why are you here? Where are my brothers, my sister? Jacob asked. He reached out to her, but she pulled away. Mother, how particular you act. You can catch a chill. Here, take my cloak. Jacob removed his cloak and held it out to her. Cautiously, the woman came forward, snatched the cloak, shooting into the shadows. As she moved from the lantern's light, her appearance changed. She was not his mother, but a beggar indeed. Jacob's cloak in hand, she disappeared into the darkness. A strange trick, he said to himself. He wrapped his arms around his chest, wishing he had kept the cloak. It is I who will catch a chill. Jacob walked on, quickening his pace against the frigid air. As he passed beneath the awning of a darkened inn, the candle revealed another form lying in the gutter. He held up the candle and again gasped. The universe has gone mad. Elon, my brother, are you sick? He set the lantern down and pulled his brother's limp arm around his shoulder, struggling to lift him. Elon, I can't carry you. He pounded on the inn's door, which was opened by a grim-faced woman. My brother is sick, and I fear he will freeze before I can come back for him. May I bring him inside? For the price of a night, she chuckled. A shilling. A shilling? Jacob reached in his pocket. I have only 6 pence. The old woman crawled and began to shut the door. Wait, my knapsack is worth more than a shilling, Jacob cried. And the trousers inside are newly tailored. I will give you everything. The old innkeeper looked at the bundle and reached out his fat hand. Jacob flung his knapsack from his back and handed it to her with the last of his money. She opened the door, bring him in. Leaving the lantern on the curb, Jacob dragged the man into the inn's foyer. As Jacob gently laid him on the wooden floor, he suddenly saw the man's face, like the beggar's, had changed. So, it is your brother who lay in my gutter, croaked the woman. Jacob gasped at the man. He is not my brother. You are mad, the woman muttered, and she shoved him out the door. Outside, Jacob picked up his lantern. He looked into its glass panes. "There's something strange about your light," he whispered. Jacob had just glimpsed the bright lights of hope when he came across a little girl shivering in the cold. "Do you think to eat, sir?" he asked in a faint voice. Jacob felt a stir at his chest. This child was tiny, no bigger than his sister. Suddenly he pulled the lamp away. He wouldn't shine it in her face. He could guess its trick. And what would he do with this poor waif anyway? He had no food or money left to give. "Have nothing," Jacob murmured as he left her, willing himself not to turn around. Penniless, cold, Jacob trudged onward, hardly glancing at the familiar houses of his childhood. His old home was dressed for the season, and music and laughter came from inside. He entered the foyer. His mother greeted him with great excitement. "Jacob," she exclaimed, "you have arrived." Hearing her voice, his sister and brothers rushed into the room to welcome his arrival. Then the party had begun to settle. His mother looked at him strangely. "Jacob, where is your cloak?" "Yes," said his brother Elam. "And why have you no backpack?" Jacob gazed solemnly into their bewildered faces. "I gave everything away," he said. "To whom?" his mother asked, puzzled. Jacob looked down at the waning Christmas candle. The old man spoke the truth. "You are costly." A smile of understanding slowly spread across his face, but of great worth. "What is this riddle? What old man?" his sister asked. "A wise man who sculptures candles," Jacob replied as he gazed at the face of his sister. And just then, in his mind, her bright face became the woeful, hungry face of the poor child. Jacob looked at the scrumptious banquet laid out on the table. Suddenly, he turned to the door. "I must see about another member of our family," he said. And as he left the warm, fragrant house in the cold night, Jacob's heart was warm with joy. For that Christmas Eve, a lesson was learned, taken to heart. We will see things as they truly are. We will find that all, from great to small, belong to one family. And this truth, known from the beginning of time, is perhaps best seen. Joyous life. What do you think of the story? Interesting. Think a little bit about what we still have in store for us. Still coming. It's just the first Sunday in Advent. We're still thinking about pausing for a little bit and asking ourselves, what are we about? What are we doing? Where are we going? What good things will we enjoy? What things might we miss? Things you think you might enjoy this Christmas? Thoughts about that? What are some things you're looking forward to? Yeah. Hanging out with your family and eating presents. You know you're into presents. Hanging out with your family. I like both of those responses. Can we do that? What else might we be looking forward to? Anybody gonna have a big table with food on it? Or are you just gonna eat like kipper snacks and crackers? You know what kipper snacks are? I like to throw that word in there. Kipper snacks, that's a good, it's a fish. So, anybody going to have something more than kipper snacks and crackers? Yeah, what are you guys going to eat? I don't know. How many of you are going to have another turkey? Anybody? Another turkey? No? Who goes to ham? Who goes, okay, I've got some ham. What else do we do? Anything else? Something? I heard, what was it, Lutheran is still on the table. Nobody ever,
downstairs yesterday and maybe some of that. There's some krumkak on, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, the krumkak is good for golfers, I hear. Very good for golfers. They eat krumkak. So, what are things that you're going to miss? Anything you thought about that you might miss? Not going to happen. Maybe a present you thought you were going to get, and you're not sure if you're going to get it. Anything else? Is there anybody missing at your table? Brother gone, sister not present, grandma and grandpa not there to share. It's a positive thing about what we're doing, right? We need to do that. We think about where we're going, what we're doing, what we're about. The arrival of the Christ child brings new life about what this is all about. And we need to pause and think about what his arrival means to us. And we'll be doing that. And next week, we're going to talk about preparing for that arrival. And then the third week of Advent, we're going to ponder the miracle of Christ's arrival. That's good for us. All of those steps towards getting to our family, our presence, the food and friends of all good things. I want you to think about something. We hear the story of Christmas, and the story is about Mary and Joseph, right? And about Mary and Joseph going to the town of Bethlehem. And the place where Mary and Joseph lived is about 100 miles from where that census was taken, where they had to travel to get to Bethlehem. You have to think of this. Think about this. Pause for a minute and think about this. Mary traveled 100 miles. You like to think that she was on a donkey, but that isn't necessarily in the story, by the way. We've introduced that into the story because we hear about the donkey Jesus rides at Easter, but we don't know that. The point is, Mary was 9 months pregnant. She was 100 miles. Walks or whatever. Bethlehem. That's messy stuff, isn't it? Messy stuff. Miracle of Christmas. Somehow doesn't work without those little details. It's, again, pause and think. What's not present here in our sanctuary today, which is normal here? You guys out there, tell me. What's not here?
Christmas trees.
Christmas trees. Not here. What else?
Baptismal font.
What's that?
Baptismal font.
Baptismal font. It's in the back, but it's not here. It's in the back. How about lights, Christmas, and lots of other stuff too, right? This is kind of messy too. I think you guys cleaned up a little bit more. When we got done, there was like leaves and stuff from something. I thought the trip would be that way, you know, like it'd be kind of messy. Like it would be if you were camping out, walking 100 miles. You know, kind of messy. And I think a little bit of mess is good for us. We're going to leave it that way for the Christmas. The light is here. The light is here. It begins now. It's going to get bigger, right? Fire is going to get a little more light to it, a little more flame to it. I want to thank you for your presence here. Because you are some of the reason why I like Christmas. I like gathering with people and friends. I like to know that that hasn't changed. That part of what we do is still there. And I celebrate that. I celebrate your presence. Make that part of my Advent and Christmas. You can go back to places. Thanks for being with me. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I hope you understand that the kids' story is the main message. If you don't know that, you wouldn't appreciate the fact that my sermon's going to be short. And that's okay. I hope that's good. We paused and found time to just spend
spend some time thinking about what we do. I like what we're doing here up in front. I like the idea of bringing the outside in. Because I think what happens often for us is we get so caught up, we don't see things anymore. We don't take notice of things. The kids have a kind of special thing going on. It's probably unnecessary to say that the focus is a little bit different this year than before. It's kind of, strange to have an owl looking over us. A good big owl kind of keeping an eye on us as we ponder things. It's a pretty good mascot for the Advent season because it tends to look like it's not doing anything. It's like it's in constant pause. And that's how owls are. If you go out in nature and you see owls, they look like they're in constant pause. I've seen owls where I thought they were not alive and suddenly they turned their heads and I realized, okay, they're still with us. But this time to pause and just think a little bit. Hopefully we can all appreciate this time of pausing and the ambiance of the outdoor coming in. Because our lives are constantly under pressure. They're constantly being pushed to go faster, to rest less. How many of you are on less rest because of Christmas and the shopping and everything? Anybody else on less rest? Boy, I tell you, there's a lot of people working hard yesterday, and I'm sure some of you are very tired from yesterday as well. And we're also constantly in that consumer mode, where we're told to consume more. So, go faster, rest less, consume more. And Advent may be a time that I think we should slow down, rest more, maybe pause a little bit more, and enjoy what we have, not necessarily what we don't have. The extended times of silence and inactivity are what give sheep a better chance to graze, more places to feed, better water to drink, and better rest. For people of faith, their needs oftentimes go unmet, and the results are evident in lives of anxiety, where peace is hard to find. So this year, during our Advent season, we will focus on those 3 weeks on themes of pausing, preparing, and the last one is pondering. Today we focus on pause. And I love we have the right here in front for us to see easily, and we'll put up new messages each week. A time to set aside and not necessarily think about what's the next thing I have to do. More about those things that we are missing or enjoying. Family, friends, places to worship, people that we care about. Maybe even times of prayer. Maybe meditation. But whatever it is, thinking about what Christmas is going to bring to us. Not what we bring to Christmas, but what Christmas brings to us. Today we focus on pause, not just the idea of pause, the practice of pause. So I'm going to give you that word, incarnation. Take a moment. Let's think about it. I was a bit hesitant to try this. The worship team, however, embraced the idea. I want to thank those on the worship team who helped set this up. Somehow, they were willing to go with what the idea that we came up with. In part, the nature is causing us or giving an opportunity to think about our lives today. What better place than to take leave from the stresses of a busy life than to walk in nature? How many of you find nature to be that which resets your stress level? Anybody do walking just to reset your stress level? Nature not only resets our stress level, but it also allows us, as it were, to just kind of breathe in the God who we don't see when we're searching for God. That somehow God is present. And God is present in a way that when we look for him, we can't find him. But when we just pause a little bit, there God is. I was thinking about, you know, this whole nature scene. I was thinking about fireplaces and how fire has always been a really stress reducer for me. I like the smell of the fire. I like the flickering of the flame. I like the warmth that it gives. I like the idea of a light in the middle of darkness. Perfect place to be still and know God. I came here yesterday. I had questions about whether this approach was the right one. You know, second guess yourself. Does anyone do that? Second guess yourself? Constantly, right? And I came downstairs and I saw the sign Mary had put on the display at the bottom of the steps. And it was, "Be still and know that I am God." And I said, "Wow, Mary, she must have saw the sign outside." And I came down and I said, "I want to thank you for putting that sign." And she goes, "No, actually, it was just something I saw on the ELCA website or something." And I said, "Well, you must have been reading my mind." What a great thing. Confirmation, which Paul said, what miracles, you know, God working behind the scenes. Be still and know that I am God. I imagine that maybe Mary had seen this the title, but she says, "No, it just came to me." What a great way for us to think about this Advent season. Being still. Being still. Knowing that God is with us. My point is simply this morning. When I'm stressed, when mentally or whatever, in my heart, in my mind, it's hard to hear messages. Especially God's messages. The story of God's son being born in Bethlehem to bring salvation to God's people. It seems simple. It's a miracle, that story, that gets lost in the constant noise of my everyday life. Worries about kids, grandkids, meeting demands of home or family. Even the church can create worries about expectations, available energy to complete one more thing. It's in the times of pausing that we retain the idea that God is with us. He is our host. He invites us to sit down at table with him. To nourish us, to sustain us. He is our refuge. He is our strength. He is our meal and our portion. So I want to take this time, this morning, as we quiet our hearts, to listen to the sound of God's voice, to call us to rest, to call us to peace. Call us in the midst of hard times to find him, silence today, as we gather here, we gather at home, go about in the midst of all the creation God has given to us. Let us focus our lives to step into life filled with light, love, peace, and hope, because God is always present. He is always there. Silence, the pregnant pauses, even in the chaos of life. May the incarnation center our lives. May the incarnation remind us of all that we have, all that we will have, all that we can count on, because God is peace with you. At this time, we invite ushers to come forward for the offering, and we will also give the announcements while the offering is being so invite the ushers to come forward. So I have at least one special announcement, and I'm going to invite Susan to come up at this time. She has an announcement about how things went yesterday.
Good morning. Those of you who know me well know how much I worry about the next day. And I tell you, the bazaar was a worry. I didn't even do a whole lot. All these other ladies just took over and did a lot. And I worried, I was in charge of the cookies, and I was so worried that we were not going to have enough cookies, because the ladies that used to bake in this shop a lot of papers. Then I came here on Friday to set up the cookies. I think, oh my gosh, I worry how we just sell all these cookies. You would not believe how many cookies we had in that basement. It was just fabulous. But we sold most of them. We have a few left, so those of you who weren't here yesterday, or those of you who were yesterday, want more cookies. We have a few left to sell. So come on down, Sue Teske will be there. She'll sell you some more cookies. And then we can say we got rid of all the cookies. So that's the goal. And we didn't quite beat bingo, but we did make about $2,500. I know Barb and Tom will be coming to get an official count this morning, but that is a really good day. We have never made $2,500 at our bazaar before. So it was wonderful. I think everybody had a good time. And the one thing that I got out of it, I think that many of you did, that we were there, we were a team and a community. It was a feeling that we were all working together. And the people that came, the youth that were there, the excitement that was generated in that lower level was amazing. So thank you all, and let's keep going. And we're all ready for next year, I think. So see you later.
There are a few other announcements, and some of them, I'm sure you can just read about them. The silent auction is still continuing for another week. We've got Toyland Express on the docket, and then senior luncheon happens. I'm correct now, correct? So I've been wrong before. December 6th at 11:30, and that's at Valentini's in Hermantown. Christmas Eve service. I just want to kind of let you know ahead of time. We do not. That's a Sunday, but we are not having a Sunday morning worship. We wanted to join so that everybody would be present and be able to be together. So instead of dividing our congregation, we have one service at 4 o'clock, and come and enjoy that. It should be a lot of fun. I know that on our third Advent service, we have music, we have people, we've got lots of stuff going on. So we're going to ponder and at the same time celebrate. We're going to do a little bit of both. At this time, I realized that I was going to have the offering come up, but before we do that, I missed the song. And that's what happens sometimes when you ponder, you miss things. So I have paused, and I'm going to invite us to join in that song. It's the insert a song in your bulletin today. So let us join in that song.
Thank you.
At this time, I invite you to turn to your friends and neighbors during this Advent season and welcome them and share a word of peace with them. Holy Communion will be very brief. Holy Communion this morning, the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for remembrance." I invite you to rise. Let us join in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Intention up in front. If you have an individual package, you're welcome to take them at this time. And you may be seated. The ushers will indicate when it's time for you to bring your out and forward. But as you come forward, we invite you to just put your hand up, grab your place in hand. Need gluten free bread, please let me know and I can make that available to you. The chalice has both grapes and wine in it, and you're welcome to fit the wafer in whichever side you would like. You'll notice that the baptismal font is in the back of the sanctuary today. Interestingly enough, that is the norm for baptismal fonts to be at the entrance of a sanctuary, because it is through holy baptism that we enter into this relationship of grace with God. But today we're going to use it as you go out. And so you'll take and place your fingers in the waters of baptism. Make the sign of the cross, and in your baptism, you leave and will go out into the world to share the good news of Christ. But come now, for all is ready for us. And I can invite you to turn to the prayer of intercession. We're going to be using the one set on your bulletin this morning. And as expected, there will be a pause after each of the petitions. With hope and expectation, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all who await God's day of restoration. Call your church into holy fellowship as we await the restoration of all things. Re-energize your faithful people to live with hope and compassion, especially those who serve as missionaries near and far. Center us on your promise to come among us and make all things new. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
All creation signals your presence, O God. The vastness of the cosmos, the turn of the seasons, the living things that both rest and flourish. Rekindle our commitment to care for the earth. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let the nations tremble at your holy presence, that justice and liberation prevail in all corners of the earth. Restore peace to nations in conflict. Teach righteousness to corrupt leaders and systems, and bring stability to areas facing uncertain futures. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Enrich the spirits of all who feel hopeless, fearful, or despairing. Stay close to those who await healing or relief. Deliver all in any need. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Be with those who keep awake at night, nurses working overnight shifts, caregivers of newborns and aging adults, stargazers, those who are anxious or those who are traveling. Reveal to all that the dark can be a place of calm and comfort filled with your presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You have sent out your angels and gather your faithful people from every time and place, calling them into one fellowship of saints. Bless the witnesses of those who dwell in your eternal presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Listen to these in all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy. Amen. We sing our sending hymn, which is hymn number 254.
Thank you.
undivided Trinity rest upon you, remain with you this day and always.
Amen.
Again, thank you for being a part of our first Advent worship service. Thank you for kids for coming and being part. And now, as we leave and take leave of this place, go in peace. Christ is coming soon. Emmanuel is with us. Thanks be to God.